You're watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. Follow along with projects and footage with a premium download available at BorisFX.com. And welcome back. We are going to be looking now at this shot, and we're going to be trying to track in something into the background over here. Now, there shouldn't be any particular trouble with being able to do this, except for one thing. And if I pause this here, we can see that one thing is just moving in front of the camera and in front of the thing that we're trying to track in, and completely obscures what we're trying to do. Okay, so how do we handle this? Well, it's actually very, very simple. We're going to use something called a track mat to cut out an area that we don't want to track. Okay, so how does this work? Well, let's set up our initial track, shall we? We'll start at the best frame that shows all the area we want to track in. And in this case, I think we'll start at the end again. That's probably a nice place. And even though I want to track in just this area here, let's take a quick look at the camera movement. Now, this looks like a nodal pan, like just a regular panorama shot on a tripod. If it wasn't shot on a tripod, it was shot by someone who was just sort of bending their body around. So that works in the same sort of way. Now, cast your mind back to the dim and distant past. We looked at a shot when we were talking about the fundamentals of planar tracking and what consisted of a plane. And I said that pans were a special case, because when we're looking at a nodal pan movement, like here, the relationship between these objects don't change in the same way as if we were using a sort of free-moving camera. So all of these areas could still be considered coplanar. And this is great for us. The only fly in the ointment could be these reflections here, because the way these reflections move could actually sort of start to throw things off, because they've got reflected light that is a different distance away from the camera, so could have a different movement. I think here it's not too bad, but just to be on the safe side, we're going to try to avoid those reflections as much as possible. But just be aware, reflections are always something to be on the lookout for. So I'm going to create my first shape, and I will create the first shape around the area that I actually want to track, taking in much more than I really need. Because remember, a lot of this is going to be obscured at some point. So the bit that I need is going to be set up with the surface. So let's set the surface up here. Let's bring that in there. I'm following the line of bricks. Bring that in there. And again, following the bricks just gets us into the right sort of place. So that's where we're trying to put something in. Now, let's make sure that when we get to this bit where things are completely obscured, that we don't have any troubles. Let's add in some more information over here. So I'm going to come in, I'm going to add the little X-spline rectangle plus, make sure it's got the plus on there, and I'm going to add in some more here. Let's just keep it sensible. So we're bringing that texture right about there. And I think this should be enough. If you really wanted to, we could come in and come in to add a bit more of a plus with the X-spline tool, and maybe add in some extra shapes around here, something like that. But I don't think we need that. I think that would be overthinking it. So I'm just going to undo with Control or Command Z and just get rid of all of that. Boom, 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 boom. Lovely. And let's see how we get on, shall we? So I'm going to rename this. So we're now in a place where we should be getting into the habit of naming our layers. And I'm just going to call this one Back Wall Track. And when we start to work with lots of layers, you know, this is going to be even more important. Let's just open this up just a little bit. Let's think about the type of motion we've got here. Well, this is a nice rigid object. And because the camera movement is just a regular pan, we can use perspective here to get the best result. And let's just track that backwards, see what we get. Okay. And that went about as well as could be expected. So let's have a little look. Let's when we had the person here moving in front of the object on the right, we got a little bit of a blip. Still able to, you know, almost get back into place again before obviously the object, the person moved completely in front of where we were tracking and just got dragged away. Okay. And then when that was out, you know, to its credit, we stayed pretty stable after that, but it didn't do the job. What can we do here? Well, the secret is to use another layer to block out the areas we don't want to be tracked. And this is called using a track mat. And I'm going to come into the middle, find where my person here is the biggest. And I'm going to just come in, make sure that I create a new layer. And I'm going to use my X-spline tool just to make it a big, very big layer around here. There we go. And I use right click just to close that shape. Just to off the surface because we don't need to see that. And I'm going to keyframe this. Just manually move this along. So let's take this a few frames backwards and see where they come into the screen. And I can just drag the little dotted transform around, bring it over here. There we go, bring it up there. Move a few frames backwards and move this out here. There we go. And this is the first frame where we want this to do anything. So if we don't want layers going across the entire timeline, here's something we can do in layer properties. So come into layer properties and we have our endpoint and our out point. Let's just expand this out so we can see the boxes a little bit clearer. And I can set my endpoint here on the layer and check out when I click this button, check out what happens on the bottom of the timeline. All of this now turns gray. So that means we don't have a layer here to be tracking. So we have red, means the layer needs to be tracked. Blue, the layer has got tracking information. And gray, which means that the layer isn't active at this time. Okay, let's come along, move forwards. We should also look at, while we're down here, I've got these little green keyframes where I've moved my shape. These represent where I've manually added in keyframes for animation. So let's move that along there. Again, I'm just going to grab the dotted white transform box. If I misclick and deselect that, then I can just click on my spline layer here and just get that back and then just move that over here. And as that moves out, there we go. I think that's well past where we need it to be. So I can come over to my layer properties again, set my out point for the last couple of frames. And let's just check to make sure that goes over the entire region. It looks like it does. Good stuff. Okay. So let's label this properly. First, I'm going to turn off the cog because we do not want to track this. I'm going to double click on my layer 2. And I'll just call this one track mat. Let's come back to our back wall. Turn on the view icon, turn on the processing cog. And I'm also going to change the fill color here because we want to see what's going on with this track mat. So if I come now into view, into mats, and it's already set to selected track mats, which is great. We'll just turn those on with Alt and 1. There we go. And so now we see the mats that we had previously. But look what happens when we have our track mat going over the top. It's cutting out from our shape here. So this means that only this area that we can see in blue is going to be tracked from now on. And let's see what happens now as we track this backwards. So we can see that as it goes over, it's starting to cut that out. All right. that's fun. So let's see what's going on here. Because at this point, everything that looked like it was going so well is now all of a sudden not going very well at all. So we've got that little one little jump there that then moves down and sort of wrecks the whole thing. And this is something to watch out for when we're working with track mats, is that as we start to cut out areas, things that seemed like they were really good, you know, solid places to track, suddenly don't seem that that interesting and full of information anymore. So, for example, this area over here, the main part with the pillar and this black part of the wall and the yellow part of the wall and the regular part of the wall, this area could almost be anywhere along this path. I mean, not on her head, you know, that's where it stops. But, you know, pretty much anywhere along there is going to be very, very similar. In the same way, we have this area over here. We've got exactly the same sort of recipe for disaster going on here. So we've got, you know, the glass and the wall and the brickwork here, all very, very similar up and down. So if we cut out a lot of this area, all of a sudden, it starts being a lot more difficult for Mocha to find out where we're going to try to track. Is this a disaster? Absolutely not. No, we can handle this very easily just by changing up what we're looking for and sort of rethinking what we're looking for with these areas. So if I come and grab these ones, and I'm going to just move this up a little bit, and I'm going to extend it outwards so that this texture extends out. Actually, we'll probably extend this out here as well. So this texture now should have some more elements that help to anchor it a little bit. And I can do the same thing to this shape over on the other side here. Maybe just bring this slightly out of danger as well. Bring that around about, maybe around about there. That should be quite interesting. I'm still wary of these reflections, but I think we should be okay. So just bring that out just a wee bit there. Okay, so now let's track this backwards, see what we get. And look at that. We've now given Mocha enough information that it needs, that even though we're cutting out almost like a third of the screen, or at least a quarter of the screen, it's still able to give us a nice, smooth track. Okay, this is the nice bit. This is always the bit that I like to save as a surprise. So let's come to our view and turn our mats off. And I'm going to turn my surface on. Let's come into layer properties and insert clip, insert our logo, and let's play that back. And take a look at that. That's absolutely perfect tracking. So we can now export that and bring that in to finish off our composite. Of course, when we do that, we are going to need to rotoscope our lady out so that this looks proper. But the tracking itself is great, even though someone walks through the frame. And that really is what we were trying to do in this exercise. So that's how we can start to use track mats and what's going on with our main tracked layer when those track mats start to intersect. And this is a technique we're going to be using time and time again in this course. And it's a technique that you're going to be using many, many times in your own shots as well. So it's worth learning it right now. We're going to take a little break now, and then we're going to come back with the final part of exercise 4, where we start to talk about one of the most powerful ways of tracking objects that go off screen or tracking longer camera movements. And that's a little technique called unlink tracking. So join me in the final part of exercise 4 after the break. You've been watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. To download all videos, projects, and footage, purchase the premium version available at BorisFX.com.